Look at them go.
I know, they're a fun gang.
I know.
Do they still have the handle?
They're hilarious. What's going on? Knock on the window.
Oh.
You can't see through this guy.
It's like a really fun silent film.
It is.
You know, Carrie talked about you quite a bit. We talked to her at Sundance, and she was quite generous about how generous you had been on set and how you kind of led the way for her a little bit.
Stop sucking up. I'm just so sick of it. You're already there. You've arrived.
Thanks.
Okay.
Yeah.
You don't need to be nice to me anymore.
Really?
No.
All right.
No. No. Say the truth.
Well.
Well, let me tell you.
We're going to get serious.
Tell you about the day you had a meltdown. There was a day on set where I kind of looked at my hand and was just like, is this hand my hand? What makes this hand my hand?
But it was the scene where he was doing the goons impression, so it was kind of all right. Everyone
it was kind of all right.
And
I
anyway.
Cannot tell in the film. I was watching it the other day and I was like, this is the scene
it's a really good
that
scene
I had like
film.
A complete meltdown. It is really good. I love how we kind of do, we're
double
doing
acting.
It together.
Yeah.
Did you know that you were so well, so good at being British going into it?
Thank you. I wasn't concerned that much about being British. I was more concerned about being Jewish. I don't know why. I think because there's nothing to act being Jewish, right? I mean, what does it mean to be Jewish? My wife is Jewish. I don't know that you would know that had I not told you.
Right.
But that's the thing that was always, I knew I could do an accent and all that sort of stuff, and I knew culturally some of what it meant to be British, and I felt like a lot of the Brits in the cast knew very little about what it meant to be British in 1960, and so I thought we were kind of on the same page in terms of trying to imagine that, but like, for some reason, for a while going in, I kept going, yeah, it's all cool, but does the character have to be Jewish? I just kept going like, what does it mean that he's Jewish? How do I do that? And they, you know, Maggie said, you just say you're Jewish. Mm-hmm. It's like, that's all it is.
So there was no resolution to it other than...
There was none.
You said the line.
Just said the line.
It's a really long story, basically, just to say that you said the
I
line.
I know, but I did have more anxiety about that than I did about being English.
Do you still get intimidated going into many of your projects?
Oh, every one, yeah.
Really? You look for that? I mean, you're looking to get pushed in that way?
I would be intimidated if it doesn't matter what it is. You know, I could be anything. It could be Peter Pan in a high school play. I would be, that
That'd
sounds
be
hard.
That'd be even scarier. That would be horrible. That's like one of those dreams
That's
you have.
That's really easy. What would be really easy? Oh, I know. Kind of a straight-faced private investigator on a TV show.
I'd find that hard.
That'd be hard too, wouldn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah.
It'd be hard to do a TV show for you, wouldn't it? To do a series?
For me to do a series? I don't know. I mean, I have no idea because I've never done one. I've done, I've guest starred on TV shows like a long time ago. Mm-hmm. And I liked it.
So you seem to like a lot of variety in the roles you choose.
I do. I would have trouble playing the same guy all the time. Yeah, that's true.
And what about superstar Carey Mulligan?
Nick won't be throwing mints at me. Yeah,
can
I told
have one?
Nick about. Do you want that? I told Nick about this part in the film where I feel I have a really false moment, and now he's decided to throw a mint at me and tell me I'm rubbish every time we watch it together. So he lobbed
a
mint.
That was a false moment in the interview. You're rubbish.
You're rubbish. So every time I do something false, now I'm going to get Nick throwing Altoids at me. I can't remember your question.
I don't remember it either anymore. So, how was it for you working with him?
We loved it. Come on. We did a play right afterwards.
Did you?
We spent the whole year doing the whole younger girl, older man dynamics.
So what was the play you did?
We did The Seagull on Broadway. Oh.
And I played Trigorn and she played Nina. And they end up together.
They have a baby together.
And they have a baby together that dies. The baby died. God, for some reason, every night when I would sit backstage and listen to that, I would chuckle. I don't know why.
The seagull as a comedy.
Oh, man.
I think it's because if you hear it so many times...
It starts to mean nothing.
It starts to mean nothing, and,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
The baby died.
Yeah. You said that line. Mm-mm. No, Mackenzie said
Mackenzie said that line.
So you're getting completely used to each other. At the
we did, and obviously we liked acting together because we did it twice.
Well, I didn't know if he would like acting with me, though, because I, the director, because we'd done it in London already, rang me, and I was in the car with him on the way to set to go and shoot the breakup scene when we were shooting in Education. And he'd been throwing ideas at me of who should take this part on Broadway, because we'd had someone else in London. And he said, what do you think about Peter Sarsgaard, who was there? And I was like, yes. Yes, but I don't know if he'll do it. And I didn't know if you, I'd be like, how can you go up to someone after 2 weeks and be like, so we've worked together for 2.5 weeks. How do you feel about spending another 4 months with me?
No, I know. We'd worked together. Yeah.
It hadn't been that long by that point.
It hadn't.
When I mentioned it to you, you were like...
Well, when you first mentioned it to me, you said, like, who do you think should play Trigorin?
I know, that's because I was trying to get you to go, me.
No, and I went... I started thinking of all my friends that were out of work actors in New York, and I just kind of went down the list of them.
I know.
And I went like, well, this one could use a job.
Well, no, because you'd already said to me that you'd... Anyway.
I'd already said that I was right. Yeah,
yeah. Exactly. So, anyway.
But then I didn't realize how good you were.
You know, you don't want to... Oh. You don't want to say to someone like, do you want to spend the rest of your year with me?
I know, I want to act with you again. Oh. But I think we should do something really light. Frivolous. You know, like an airport comedy. You're going to Toledo. You know, no, like one of those ones where it's like, I'm on my way to Rio, yeah. And you're on your way back home to Tacoma. You're from Tacoma.
Oh, nice.
And you meet me in the airport in the first class lounge.
Yeah.
And you change your flight and go to Rio with me, and an adventure starts.
That's right. It.
That's right. It.
I think you could probably get a French director to make this movie.
That's our next project. You just pitch that. Who's out there that can do that? Michel Gondry. And then he can make it all arty and pretty and beautiful. And
Yeah. I love it. I love it. He will.
So now he's making a comic book movie, of all things.
Oh, yeah.
Like Michel Gondry making The Green Hornet.
Yeah.
They're all making comic book movies because, you know, that's the only thing that can get financed. Yeah. Either that or a fart comedy. You know, I mean, honestly.
Us could be a comic book. We could write the comic book and then the movie.
Or it could be a fart comedy.
It could be.
And do you have any urge to do a fart comedy or a comic book? Either one of you?
Comic book.
I've never been a fan of comic books, to be honest.
No, that's the thing. If you're a fan, I think it's different. And I think that's why boys like it so much, because they read them. But I've never read any.
I mean, I've always been a little suspicious.
Do you have Beano here? With Beano and Dandy in London, in England. Beano and Dandy are like comic books. But they have like Dennis the Menace and Desperate Dan, who's the big chin who eats cow pies.
And none of these sound like a good role for you.
They're not really comic book heroes. They don't have any superpowers.
Cow pies.
like big horns sticking out of them.
Well, I've always wondered if there were no money in playing superheroes, right? Playing a superhero part was sort of like, you know, scale plus 10. If actors would still be as drawn to them.
Right. I think boys would.
They still would.
Yeah.
What's the villain role that always is the, you know, juicy thing for... somebody to
well,
play.
The best role is the lead, you know, guy who's a little bit of a villain. You know,
oh,
like
the dangerous guy.
The dangerous.
But he's still good.
Still
inherently
good. Inherently good, but not all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's the one you want to be.
Yeah.
Christian Bale character.
Yeah.
So there was a lot of screaming on your set? Is that what you're trying to say? A lot of screaming at the DP on the set of an Education? Is that...
Oh, you know, I understand. Yeah, I understand getting upset. You know, listen, I don't think anybody knows what it means to be the lead in, like, how many multi-million-dollar movies in a row, and I certainly have never experienced that stress, but I've been around it, and it looks tough. You have a lot of people worried about what you're doing every day and going, like, is he offending middle America right now, or does he need to be like a little bit calmer and smoother? You know, really. And the great thing about a lot of the roles that I've gotten to play, including this one, is no one has ever had an opinion about who I might be offending or carrying along, or because I don't play many characters that do that.
Is that because Lone is protecting you in a picture like this?
Who?
The director, is it Lone?
Yeah, but I mean, the characters, it's not important that the audience love me or hate me at certain points. You know, it's just it could go so many different ways. Mm-hmm. That to think, oh, they need to love me in the beginning and hate me in the end, which in general is, you know, something that tends to happen in this movie. You know, there are people that have opposite feelings. You know, it's all right. It doesn't affect the plot of the movie, which is a train that is inevitable and is going to happen no matter what.
Levels of attraction to your characters vary, though, don't
they? They do. Some people are, honestly, I've had, women tend to be more forgiving. A lot of men, I think, because they're like, want to distance themselves from me. Say, like, you're pretty creepy in this. And a lot of women are like, yeah, you're just kind of a little boy, you know.
A lot of men have come up to me and said they want their daughters to watch this. And they see it as like a message, like a warning. They're like, I want my 13-year-old daughter to see this movie.
Oh, okay. That'll do it.
Yeah, no worries. It's like a sex education video.
Yeah.
You're all good.
But you do have to love you at the beginning, the middle, and end, right? Do you even think about it? Are you concerned about being lovable?
She's
on camera?
So winning, she doesn't even know how not to be.
I just exude it.
You just exude it.
Put it out. No, you don't think, you can't think about what they'll think of you. Can you, really?
You can't.
Because, I mean, I just tried to play what Nick had written and alone just adjusted things. And but if you try and think about the film as a whole in any way, then you're really screwed.
But I like that you are responsible on a basic level for what happens to you, that you are, you partake in some of the deception also, you know, and
enjoy the deception, like getting that book and writing that fake message and being like, here you go, and presenting it to the parents. Like,
and I think that's what keeps the movie from being simple or sappy or saccharine, is that, you know, it's, she participates.
And our double act we've got going.
Oh, yeah,
we developed
this
really good double act. By the time he's trying to convince him to let me go to Paris, we've got a whole
way of being with them. Exactly. Exactly. I love it with you hiding over behind the furniture with the presents. You actually reminded me of Ramona in that scene.
Aww.
Like, just taking a bunch of presents and then just disappearing with them. It's like, you know, finding her eating a piece of chocolate underneath the table or something like that, you know.
Well, Fish Tank is an interesting, it's at the festival and it's been around now since, like, it can. And it's kind of like an opposite number to An Education, where Michael Fassbender plays your role. And the girl is, it's a much harsher version of it. And this one manages to be both warmer and so therefore more accessible. You know, it's such a tough movie, Fish Tank is. But it's a very similar kind of thing, where it's the girl who's trying to figure it out.
I did, Katie Jarvis, who plays the girl in Fish Tank. She's never done anything before this film. She was 16, I think, 16 or 17 when she shot it. And she was in Telluride, so we did like a discussion about like being British and girls and acting and stuff. She was amazing. She's an amazing, amazing girl. But
it's darker.
Yeah, yeah.
Is it rated R?
It's got the Ken Loach thing. You know, it's like, it's
Is it a Ken Loach film?
It's not a Ken Loach film. It's Andrea Arnold who did
Andrea Arnold. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Did Red Road, so it's
Who also tough. Did a little short about a bee that goes into a baby's mouth.
Huh.
Yeah, that was one of her first shorts. She's incredible, director.
She's really cool as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, but very edgy, you know, much more, you know, just raw and handheld and, you know, in slums, and it's a very tough movie, but rewarding in the same way. It seems like there are a lot of themes that are kind of floating around of people trying to find what they're supposed to be when they grow up, and, you know, with a lot of films that are around right now, for some reason, it seems to go that way.
Come in batches.
It is strange how it happens. Themes seem to fit. So what do you look for these days for in terms of how you just choose a project? Is it the script? Is it the director?
Something that might actually happen. It's very hard for films to get financed these days, and I'm 100% certain that this movie would not be made right now
if it were
brought to anyone. Certainly no American studio, if you brought them this script and this cast and this director and this writer, would make this movie right now. They would miss it. So, you know, there's just, if you're trying to find something like this right now, it's kind of difficult. So I've been kind of looking for, you know, interesting large movies or interesting very, very, very small movies, like under $1 million.
And Carrie, are you, now that you're the queen of all America, I mean, it's amazing how much love there is for you already in the media. Is, you know, they've already kind of given you the Oscar and sent you on your way.
Then you don't have to go through the whole hassle of that damn thing. Yeah.
Well, you've been through this too. You've been through the
The award stuff.
The award stuff, have, the sure yeah. bet, and the, you know, it's all guaranteed, locked up, done. So I'm sure you have some advice for Carrie in that regard, but...
Work.
Yeah, no, I'm working. I'm doing a job. I'm filming.
Don't think about it too much.
It's, well, you will think about it too much if you're not working. It's just hopeless. We're conditioned to do that. But if every day you're on set having to work on something else, you know as an actor that your attention has to be on that, and you won't be able to have, like, the silly daydreams until it's time to have the silly daydreams.
So you're working.
I'm working, yeah.
And what are you looking for? Do you have films that you want to make? Do you have things that you're looking to put yourself out for these days? Or?
Yeah, there's one at the moment that I'm desperate to do, but I don't think I'm going to get it. But I haven't auditioned for it yet. I tried to get you to help me, actually. I was trying to do an audition tape.
We haven't had much time, have we?
I know, no, we didn't. We got here, and I texted Peter, and I was like, I need help putting myself on tape, and then we couldn't end up doing it. And I tried to do it on my own, so I learned all the lines in the scene. I learned the lines of the other character, and I tried to do the thing where you pause and... Mm-hmm. And
that's crazy.
It was really... And then I had one of those little flip cameras, and I was recording myself, and it ran out of battery, and now it's... So now I've got over it. It's the whole thing, but I'm desperate.
Tell them to wait.
They won't wait. They'll give it to somebody else.
Who?
I told you. Anyway, so yeah, I get like really, really. But it
call her and tell her not to take it.
Hire a hitman.
No, just call her and say, you know how bad you're going to be in this movie. They don't know who it is.
You should need to do a Vegas lounge act, I think.
But mainly I'm just thinking about the job I'm doing now. And that's good, because when we were in Telluride, we went, I've gone bright red now. Thank you so much. No, we had this lovely weekend, but then I'd have like little ideas about what I was going to do in some scene that I'm shooting in 2 months, and that's nice.
Yeah, thinking about the job. Yeah, actors love acting. They don't, and they also love awards. But I always believe fundamentally, actors love acting more than awards. Hopefully,
dressing up
good ones. Yeah, and I think that is such a godsend that you've got not only a job but a good job.